So hello everybody, let me start here with a short video. So first of all, I will show you a short video how actually it is done. So what we are doing here is when you have an API, so it has a business purpose. So this shows a sample from retail, but it also works for banking. Yeah. So it has all the components which actually is needed when you are exposing an API. So this is an event-driven API. You see here that you have here social login, that you have a store, yeah, as I said, but it also works with banking, it works with insurance. We have customers for all industries. So the basic idea is that you're seeing something, so you're checking the inventory, you're calling an artificial intelligence API, you're making a photo from, in this case, a shoe, sporting shoe, then you look something similar, you do go to a store, you are buying it, you will get an order number, you will get connect to a live chat because you want to see when actually do you really get it delivered. So these are all components of a process, and behind all of this, there are APIs. So one is a chat API, in this case it's from Watson chat. For the other case, it's the order API, that the third one is an event, so Kafka API. And then after that, what you really trigger at the end of the day is that now you actually really have done an order. So, and we are showing in this short video how we have implemented that. And then I will cover in the third part of the presentation what is behind the technology. So first of all, we are creating here event streams. So it's a Kafka event. So the Kafka events listens on some methodologies. So he goes to a topic, you are creating a topic. This topic then is basically listening on the incoming events. In this case, as I said, it's from a store, but it also can be from you have an insurance, and the insurance, somebody buys a car and he wants to trigger, and you are automatically triggering an event for creating a quote for buying a car insurance. So, but at the end of the day, what you are really doing is you are connecting to your back-end application. So what you do is you create, in this case, a queue. This queue listens on this incoming event. So, and this is what the importance behind is. This is all within one integration platform, because integration platform means that you not only have really the API itself, that it drives a business purpose, that it's built into an overall integration architecture, that it really is built into an event-driven API. So in this case, once we have triggered this event, you are basically opening this JSON, so the Swagger document, you can find it here. You are checking the inventory, so that you immediately can respond back to the customer, okay, the inventory is here, what does it really do, so that you can really now then manage also the API, that you say, okay, I have created this API, I have listened to the topic, yeah, from event streams, and now I'm publishing this, yeah, so I'm publishing it so that developers, yeah, so this mobile developer can consume this API, yeah, so that's also important. And I will show you then a sample of how such a developer portal looks like, where you can find it. So you have the store, the order API, that you really can now see how this all fits into the integration architecture. And that's why we really have here, so this is part of our tool, yeah? So I've added the link when you get the presentation. All of this, what you can see, can be really done online, yeah? So you are subscribing to our API management tool on IBM Cloud Public. You get create a free account, and I got in the last 2 days a lot of questions. So it doesn't cost anything until 50,000 calls per per month. So, and then you subscribe to it and you can create it on your own. So when we look at it now, what was behind what we have seen here? So my name is Peter Brabec. I'm managing API economy, data power, cloud packs, all this for Europe. I'm supported here by Bruno, Juan, by the local teams. So whenever you have questions, we always can follow up. So what really is behind this technology? What we have seen is we have seen all of the screens now. Here is the workflow basically, yeah, so it's for airlines, retail, as we have seen, mobile apps. It triggers an API, it calls some integrated MQ, and it calls your backend application from an API. So what does it mean when we are doing that? Yeah, so here's the link, how you can access it. And now focusing a little bit into the technology behind it. So when we look at it, so the API itself also has a full life cycle. So you are creating an API, so then you are starting to test it. Yeah. So testing an API means that there are several ways of testing it. Is the API available? So it's monitoring from outside. Yeah. So we also cover this API test and monitor. Then you say, okay, I have my YAML file, I'm publishing my YAML file into an API manager. So the API manager has now version one. You are starting with the version one of the application lifecycle. You are basically also publishing it to a portal. So when you say, okay, publishing it to a portal, in this case, it becomes visible to an external API consumer community. So what you also want is socialize with the community. So means if you're changing from version one, you have now version two, which means that in maybe 6 months you start to retire version one. You don't want to write letters or emails. You want that the people are interacting via this portal. So you also want to monetize this API. So monetization means several things. Monetization means you want to charge if somebody subscribe to this API, which usually is a first step but never used. Yeah, because if you start to charge for using an API, the app developer consuming this API will not consume it because he doesn't get anything out of it just consuming this API. So that's why there are other methodologies of monetizing an API. Monetizing an API means, and I worked with Tel Aviv Stock Exchange, where they said, okay, if you have a stock rate from last week, yeah, so for Amdocs, it's free of charge, but if you want to have a history data, basically for this history data, we are charging you something. It results in an API call. The API call triggers the data from a database and sends it to the customer. Yeah? So this is the basic idea. And then you are monetizing the content what the API delivers. So all of this, or I had a discussion with, he's not here. So I had a discussion with somebody who he asked me, okay, how can we actually monetize the consumption of an API? So we provide you with analytics data, and you can feed the analytics data into any internal, external, whatever chargeback system so that you see who is calling the API, how often is it called, what is the response time, the service level, so that you really can monetize on the consumption, on the content of the API, but also, as I said, on the subscription, but nobody uses that. So this consumption also has some analytics background. Yeah. So as I said, we'll cover the product architecture a little bit, the monitor. Then you say, okay, I'm now publishing version two, I'm creating a new one, and then I'm going into the test phase again. So all of this is basically done within our product. Yeah. So this is the product API management. As I said, the full integration architecture still has something to do with event streams, but I'm focusing here on this API product. So when we say now, okay, we have seen all of this, yeah, so what is behind the scenes? You have also an organization, yeah? So when I'm traveling around and seeing going to Europe and then talking to customer, it means, first of all, what is the business value of an API? So you are establishing, many of the customers in establishing a so-called product manager. Yeah, so he sits somewhere in the line of business. So for a Volvo or whatever, yeah, so he says, okay, what is the information we can provide to the outside world? So it's kind of a development of a solution from outside in, yeah? So you're not saying, okay, this is what I can offer to the world, please take it. You are now in the shoes of your consumers, of your API consumers, and say, okay, this is what we can offer. And then he starts to go to the API developer. The API developer starts with our toolkit or with whatever you want to create this API. He publishes it to the API manager, and from there you are deploying it to the API gateway, and the API manager also gives it to the developer portal. So when we now look at the developer portal, yeah, so we have seen one before from another vendor. I show here from Santander Bank. So Santander Bank is, yeah, this is the UK one. Santander Bank, one of our customers, he has now basically built such a developer portal. And when you look at here, so you first of all see all here this socializing, yeah? So in the support, so how you get started, what is open banking, yeah? So what are the frequently asked questions behind it, yeah? So you really can now say, okay, and you can have one common interface to the customer where you have all the documentation behind it, yeah? And this can be, this is based on Drupal, so whatever you want, you can design it, whatever Drupal can do. So in any case, so this is what you are actually defining in a developer portal, which is the representation of the repository. So this is the APIs you have. So it's open banking, account information system, payment information, open data. Yeah, so you can read through this portal at home if you want. But basically, it is really the representation of the content of the external published APIs. So, which also means when you now say, okay, I have some internal APIs, I have some external APIs, you are defining in our manager who can access it, what is visible, yeah? So what is visible to this world, what is visible to the outside world. You don't have to have many solutions. You have one API manager and you can publish it to the portals, to the products as you like, yeah? So you don't have redundant information. Also very important that you have one common repository in your product as well. So we have many samples of that. I will now move on. So when we look here at what we have seen here is the API manager. As I said, the app developer sees the portal, he registers for the portal, and then in parallel, we are deploying the policy, the security policy, the transformation policy, we are deploying it to the API gateway. So the API gateway is the runtime. So every API consumer actually goes then via the runtime. So which means in terms of security, you have to identify. So in the case, if you remember the mobile app, yeah? So the mobile app is, this mobile app allowed to use the API. So it's an application level security. Then you identify the user behind it, yeah? So you are stepping up now, you have some step up security in case of the banking, that you say, okay, account information system, is the particular user of the mobile app allowed to access his account information? So it means now that we are communicating here with an LDAP directory or with a ping directory or whatever directory you have. That means that we are here incorporating here the OAuth servers, the existing infrastructure you are using already. Yeah? So whatever you are using, we can reuse, We can integrate. However, if somebody says, no, I don't have anything in OAuth, I want to use OAuth as part of the solution and introduce it, this solution also can act as an OAuth server. So we can be an OAuth client and an OAuth server. And once you have identified all the security steps, once you have identified the users, you are basically forwarded to the URL, so to the endpoint, and then you are transforming the data with the transformation policy, and then you can resend the response back. And in order to do that, what and why it's a cloud-native architecture, all of our infrastructure is really, it's a Dockerized architecture, so it's fully based on Docker containers. And if you look at here, we have four functionalities. So one is the portal container, one is the management server, one is the analytics node, and one is the gateway instance. So these are the four functionalities, and then you see a vertical instance, and why we have three here, in Kubernetes terms, it always should be an odd number. So when you look at the Kubernetes architecture, it usually shall be, it has a quorum, yeah, concept of quorum. This means if you have two and you are losing one, you still will lose the service. So this means that with three, having three or five or whatever, you and losing one, then you will still have a quorum and the other one can recover this node. So this means that our product is really fully Dockerized. It's already really running, up and running also in production in a Kubernetes Docker architecture. And when we look at it, so first of all, it's one license, yeah, but also what it means, this module can be run in a hybrid architecture. This means, and we have customers which say, okay, I don't want to have the skills, I want to be building it very, very fast. So they say, okay, please, IBM, manage the management server for me. So we are doing all your operations for the API management solution. But then because of latency, because of legal requirements, yeah, it means that you still have in some circumstances run the analytics data because it really contains some customer data. Yeah, so it's the analytics data, which where you also can analyze the payload. Yeah, so it's a parameter, whether it's just the headers or it's also the payload. So that we are now say, okay, even if we are managing all the environment for you, yeah, so we say, okay, portal and management managed by IBM, but you still can now pull the gateway and install it locally. So it's still one license, yeah, so you only have to provide the infrastructure. And what's also the beauty is, and that's why we speak here from hybrid architecture in a hybrid multi-cloud world. We have customers, yeah, in Sweden, I have a retail furniture shop which says, okay, I'm managing everything out of Sweden in Helsingborg. But I have shops in China, yeah, so in China they have AliCloud, in Russia there is Softline Cloud, yeah, and then they're running on Google Cloud, yeah. So they say, okay, please, I need an architecture where the gateway, and if you look at Gartner or whenever all the analysts, the gateway must be as close to the application as possible. So which means you now take the gateway instance, you take the analytics instance, you are buying an Azure OpenShift container, and then you are deploying the gateway and the analytics directly in Azure, and you have one point of communication to your management server. So this is all what can be implemented with this hybrid Dockerized architecture, and as I said, already in production in many customers. And if you say, no, I'm not want IBM to manage, I'm still in, want to manage it on my own, you're buying the servers in your data center and you can install it and run it self-managed in your data center. So now when we look at all of this and then we are switching back on the bigger picture, it says now we have, you can, how do you trace, yeah? So because We have a response time in the gateway, we have a response time in the backend, we have a response time really in Kafka, in event streams. So you really want to monitor the end-to-end response time. So you can monitor and you can test it for the particular infrastructure for API Connect, but this picture also gives you a view how in the future, so you can say, okay, instead of just doing it on a product basis, I want to have an end-to-end monitoring. So this really gives you additional value of just a hybrid architecture of a cloud-native architecture where you can really see with this cloud pack running on OpenShift, where you really can say, okay, I now can give you a view end-to-end in terms of monitoring, in terms of licensing, in terms of deployment and operation. So, and now when you say, okay, fine, yeah, so love the approach, but I have an existing environment, yeah? So my developers are developing today locally on their laptop, yeah? So do I have to change all of this? Actually, what we recommend is do whatever you do today and integrate the API management solution into your data center, into your processes. And in order to do that, we have here everything what you can do in the product, yeah, with the graphical user interface. So if you are going to this link before and you are testing it on IBM Cloud, you have a graphical user interface, you will play around, but whatever you do there can be done with the REST interface. So you easily can integrate it into your existing environment via REST. You see all the REST commands here, yeah, so what can be done. But if you start to develop with Angular and then you have your YAML file and then you want to publish it into the API manager, this will be a REST call, then you're applying the policy, REST call, post, get, and whatever, yeah? So, but also what we do is, one of the new popular things is that you're not moving everything to REST, that we are starting also with GraphQL. So our support, and I added this slide because a couple of people asked me, so whether what is behind it. Yeah, so we have in our framework, there is a loopback development. So and with this loopback development, you really can do GraphQL SQLs calls, yeah, GraphQL APIs. So it also provides you a way of how to create GraphQL APIs instead of REST APIs. So this is also included in API Connect, as well as here, yeah, you see here test and monitor. It's very often used that you say, okay, what is my API? What is the response time? Is it answering? So you are setting up a project. You can import the project directly from our tool, and then you set up here a monitor and can really test it end to end. It provides you these benefits. Yeah, I will not go through all the benefits, but yeah, so it's really very popular. So if somebody is familiar with Postman, it's basically a replacement of Postman with some additional functionalities. So, and it's included, currently it's free of charge for everybody, yeah, because it's in early test stages, yeah. But if you're familiar with Postman, maybe it's worth to look into it. It's also available on IBM Cloud homepage. So what we also have, and that's what customers are really asking for when they are starting to develop the APIs, so they have their YAML file and now they want to run it. Yeah? So they want to run it against the mock service, they want to run it against a test data. And then we also provide here step-to-step debugging. Yeah? So you are downloading a so-called API toolkit. The API toolkit is a toolkit which runs in a local test environment. And in this local test environment, you really now can do some step-by-step debugging. Yeah? So when we look at it, and the overall concept also allows you for the life cycle management as well as for versioning. Yeah? So each version you are publishing, and what you have seen it on the portal from Santander before, when you look at it, it really means that you have a version, and behind the version you have a life cycle. So, and these are two independent things. Yeah, you can say, okay, I'm publishing version one in production, version two is still in test, then version two goes into production, you are depreciating, yeah, so version one, which means, okay, they still can use it, but nobody can subscribe to it anymore. So then you are retiring version one and put version one, version two in production, and then you say, okay, archive. So it means now for each version, you can have a separate life cycle, all managed in our API tool. And when we look at the cloud native approach and why it's cloud native, so when we look at it, we have working together, and as you know, IBM and Red Hat, IBM bought Red Hat recently, so that we said, okay, our strategic way to go will be everything on OpenShift, that you say, okay, I have the same common programming model, whether it's on-premise, whether it's run in any of the clouds, whether it runs on the mainframe, wherever it runs, you have the same common operation model, you have the same common monitoring, so it comes with the common services that you can say, okay, and I'm delivering this across all platforms, across all clouds, and I can work really cloud native directly. So I'm finishing now. Are there any questions?
I know IBM has the DataPower. So sometimes I'm confused. Sometimes I hear people say, well, I'm going to use DataPower as a gateway, basically gateway is a separate product, or like WSO2, et cetera, et cetera. When do we use DataPower or not?
So our API gateway is DataPower, period, yeah? So DataPower has a lot of services, yeah? So it has a web application firewall, it has an XML firewall, it has transformation, AAA, so it offers a lot of services. And one service which DataPower offers is the so-called API gateway. So for existing DataPower customers, I came from Brussels on Wednesday, and they are existing DataPower customers. They want to use it as API gateway as well. They just switch on the service and connecting it to the API manager. So that's basically the answer. So if you are you existing DataPower user? Or? Yeah. So if you have a multi-protocol gateway in production, this still is untouched, and now you can use the new API gateway service. This came with version 7.7. It's just a firmware upgrade. Yeah.
Any more questions from the crowd? No? Okay. Thank you again, Peter.